52 years, oh Lord. I guess that makes us older than dirt. Now I look out there and I see a lot of you are close to our same age. I want to thank you for staying up this late to see the show. Every moment is like, yeah, Jeopardy's over, I can put my jammies on now. Gotta say, it's great to be here in Artesia. Great to be here in Cerritos, gateway to Artesia. Oh my God, help. We're gonna do a song by our good buddy Terry Kirkman, who retired from the group in 1984 and became a substance abuse counselor. What better training than to have been in a rock and roll band? Terry and I sang the lead on this, and he's not here tonight. His plane doesn't get in for another couple of years. So I'm going to introduce you to a young man back here hiding behind all the brass. We affectionately refer to him as Cymbal Face. He comes to us from El Cajon, California, way down there by San Diego, where he raises huge drugs and avocados that are like footballs. He also is kind of responsible for getting Gary Puckett going again after the Union Gap went away. Had a band down there in San Diego, took him under the wing with him, and away they went. Please welcome Mr. Bruce Pictor. And we're going to do this for you because we debuted this our third time on the Smothers Brothers show. Anyway, it's called Everything That Touches You. Yeah. started touring, we played with a lot of great groups, but we hardly ever got to see any of them perform because we were an opening act then, and we'd be on stage and they'd be either at the hotel or on the way. And then when we got off stage and they were on, we'd be on our way back to the hotel, and then off to the airport to the next town. Then in 1967, we opened the Monterey Pop Festival, which was just a wonderful treat because we were the first act on, and for the rest of the three nights, we had seats about that far away, and we got to see everybody. And every now and then, I try and remember all the groups that were there, and the magic scented air, and it was the... I don't know what it is, but I don't remember, man. No, I do remember. Everybody was there. It was great fun. And we opened with this next song, which we kind of hoped would be the battle cry of the youth movement that was going on then. And in a way, it became that. And in honor of that, we're going to introduce you to our youth movement. This is our first second generation associate, easy for me to say, yeah. And he is the son of our original bass player. He comes to us from the great Northwest, Spokane, Washington. One of those guys who can sing and play everything. Please welcome Mr. Jordan Cole.
Thank you. Every time I come back here, I'm startled by how beautiful this room is. Captain hiding, the cloud on the ladder of my role.
Sinatra would do it, and then other artists would do it. You know, you said, oh, God, Jerry Lewis did it one time. And the whole batch, everybody did it. And the best one who did it, that's the song that got the big hit. Well, in the 60s, when we were coming up, that wasn't, you didn't do that. You had to write your own songs, arrange them, and everything. It was just uncool to do anybody else's material. But now, we're old enough, we don't give a damn about that anymore. We could care less. And so we're going to do a song that somebody else recorded. And we actually recorded it too, but didn't sell beans, so I don't care. So much fun to do. And we hope you guys sing along if you like. It's called Walk Away Renee.
Brothers entitled Never My Love. Thank you for your meager applause. Still has to carry the water bucket occasionally. Great bass player, great singer, a wicked pool player. Woo! Gotta get some pool buddies out here. When he was a teenager, he took Minnesota Fats for 5 big ones. They call him the Hawaiian Eye from Honolulu, Hawaii, Mr. Dale Ramos.
Since you're already not from Hawaii, how about everybody giving me a big aloha?
Aloha!
All right. Mahalo. I get to introduce this song. It's my favorite of all the songs that we do. I'm sorry, guys, but this is my favorite. And anyway, I'd like to do some dedications. The first dedication is a very important one. It's for all of our troops, veterans, and first responders. I'd like to thank all of our friends and family, everybody we know that came tonight. It's so much fun to be here in this beautiful theater. It's my favorite in the country. It really is. Thank you for coming. Last of all, I'd like to dedicate this to my mother. We just had a birthday in September. She's 98 years old. And her name is Mom.
Thank you.
we can see more people out there. It's so hard to see them. Okay, just leave it there. This next song that we're about to do is, it's a really fun song. You've heard it, all of you have heard it, I'm sure. I'm gonna give you a little story that kind of sets this song up. about 50 years ago, when I just got into the business, I was sitting at home and my phone rang. I picked it up to answer it, and it was one of those Prince's pink phones with the 30-foot extension cord, you know? And it was one of those high-tech ones, right? And so she asked me if, a lady on the other end said, asked me if I'd like to go with her to a Halloween party in Beverly Hills. I said, sure. About 2 days later, she sent a limo out to my apartment, and I got in and went to this beautiful mansion in Beverly Hills. We ended up in the back garden, which is about as dark as it is in here. And I looked at the back wall, and I saw this huge flower, and it just kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and I couldn't figure out what was going on. And finally, I realized that it was getting closer. So just getting bigger and bigger, and all of a sudden it stops about 5 feet in front of me, and I didn't know what was going to happen. And all of a sudden, rushes forward, puts arms around my neck, and I hear this real pretty voice in my ear, and it says, Del, you have to stick with what you're doing because your band is really going to make it. And when I pulled back to see who it was, it turned out to be Cass Elliott of the Mamas and Papas. And so as a tribute to the Mamas and Papas, we do this song. And we've done more concerts with the Mamas and Papas than any other rock and roll band. And you'll love it. You know, if you want to sing along, please do.
Oh,
association is defined as a gathering of people gathered together for a common cause. It has a cause too great for any one person. There's no one person in charge. It is a collective group effort to tackle this monumental task. It is not that some of the members are the association. It is the sum of the members that are the association. It is a whole that is greater than the sum of all parts. And we like to call it whole sum music. This one includes math.
Silver and gold, silver and gold.
Some things pass this, my heart and
got a big hit. No, I said, okay, wait. We were playing the Philippines a couple of years ago, and we did it for Valentine's Day, and I don't know if you know about the Philippines on Valentine's Day, but it's like Christmas on steroids. It's incredible. Oh boy, the whole island's just, they really, really do it right. And so we were about to go on, and this woman came up to me and said, "You guys, you're going to do your big hit, right?" I said, "Oh yeah, sure." And Emily said, "No," and she told me the name of the song. It was a song we had no idea was a hit in the Philippines. It was just massive over there. And well, we ended up disappointing many Filipinos that night because we had forgotten the tune. Just we didn't play it very much or not. Well, it was a tune we did, okay. But it was, and so in order to never disappoint Filipinos anymore, or anybody who heard the song, we would relearn the song, and we did relearn the song, and we ended up really liking it because it's fun. This guy wrote it, he's gonna sing it, and we'll give it to you.
He was our vocal arranger, and he's a fine American and a great cigar from Chattanooga, Tennessee, Mr. Jules Alexander.
Thanks a bunch. This tune is, well, what happened with this tune? We were going to play, I wrote it a number of years ago, and it was our first time to play in New York City. We were on our way there, and I don't know if you know about it, but musicians, first time you play in New York City, we're from LA, first time you play in New York City, I think, oh my God, we're going to be killed. You know, it's a mean city, it's this, it's that, you know, and, oh, yuck. So we landed in New York, and we went to the hotel, we stayed at the Warwick, right near the park, and I got my stuff up in my room and said, okay, I'm going to go fight the dragon, I'm going to go find a hamburger or something, you know. So I walked out the front door, and some lady starts just screaming at me, this little lady, and I thought, oh, yeah. And she was really going off on me. And I looked at her, and she looked like my grandmother. And I thought, this sounds familiar. And then I looked over, and there was a guy offloading stuff in the truck. He looked like my uncle. I'm not kidding. You know, the weird, crazy uncle never did any good. Well, that was, yeah, that was, it looked like him. And I realized that New York is like a family, man. People, you know, the crazy grandmother, you know, yells at you, the uncle, no good, nothing, never did nothing anyway. They were all there, and I all of a sudden felt very comfortable. I knew exactly what it was about, and I thought, oh, this is gonna be good. So, being a songwriter, I said, So I ran up to my room, just went back up, and immediately wrote a song about Dubuque, Iowa. I don't know how that happened. It just happened. Science. Yeah. No, that's not science. That's art. Art and science. Yeah, sart and ions, or something like that. It's called Dubuque Blues. Oh, thank you. And we'll do it. Do you remember Dubuque? Have you ever heard of that? It's half between York and California. There is a highway getting back, and there's an active railroad track, and the west side of the city now settles there. And I can't recall the instances that keep it in my thoughts.
demo songs, because once you've had a hit, everybody and their brother sends you demo songs. And sometimes in an afternoon, we'll listen to 150, 200 demo songs. And after a while, if you don't hear anything in the first 10 or 15 seconds, next! And you wind up passing on a lot of great songs that you didn't get to hear develop. We passed on Joy to the World, The Air That I Breathe. MacArthur Park was written for us, but that's another whole long story. We heard one song one afternoon I just loved, and I lobbied heavy for it, and it got turned down. And a couple years later, the Eagles had a big hit with it. Oh, I was crushed. Well, since then, I've begged and pleaded and bribed, and I finally convinced the guys to let me do it for you. Now, the Eagles changed it considerably, and I'd like to do the original for you. And it's a very poignant song, so I'd like to ask for a little moonlighting, please. Maybe not quite so moody. Avocado, what makes you think you're so holy? You're just guacamole to me. You're a green one, I know, and you're not in season. These hands that are squeezing you, gonna eat you someday. Don't you mind that? Thank you.
It's not important, actually, that you know the name. I forget it from time to time. Senior moments, yes, they come. Boy, I tell you, I never thought we'd be singing this song, and I'd be singing this song in my 50s. Maybe I didn't. I don't know. He's known me 52 years, I've known him 46. It's just it's one of those science things, you know, I don't understand.
Science!
Yes. This is my man, Jim Yester from Birmingham, Alabama.
Sometimes that Alabama just sneaks out. Just proves you can take the boy out of the country, but you can't make him think. After the show, there's a big long table out there in the lobby somewhere, and we have some pictures to sign, and you know, we'll autograph things. If you need a personal bite mark, I'm sure we'll take care of that. But you know, it's very humbling for an artist to drag their wares in and sell them. It's much more humbling to drag them back out to the truck. This song was our first national hit, and when we released it, about half of the stations in the country refused to play because it was so controversial. Anybody listen to the radio lately?
Excuse me, Jim, but I remember when Ho was just Don's last name.
Yes, true that, Don.
I'm not going to touch that. People always ask us what this song is about, and I guess if you got to ask, you ain't never going to know. Anyways, from us to you, thank you so much, and God bless you all.
Thank you.
to be back in LA. Oh, man, so cool. Thank you so much. You know, it's so great to get that kind of reaction. This is the start of a series of things that we're doing. I think it's so great to experience, you know, to have that kind of collaboration and all the joy. What I want you to understand is important to us.